Greetings, everyone, and welcome to another edition of In Studio. I'm your host, Ted Perch, and today we are sitting with multimedia artist John Landino. Welcome to the program, John.
Thank you very much for having me today.
So you described yourself as a multimedia artist, and you're also a sculptor. So how did you get into sculpting, and how did you get into art, being an artist?
My whole life I've always been drawing from when I was a young child, and it was kind of a strength that I had. And my drawings developed over the years into more sculptural forms. Mm. And in the late 70s, I was actually videotaping myself doing my drawings, and the goal was to try to get the drawing to come out of the paper. So I was interested in perspective and three-dimensionality. Mm-hmm. And one of the last pieces I did was a ball coming off a ramp, mm-hmm. coming right out at the viewer. And I worked on that, and finally I said, well, wait a minute, if I'm trying to get this out here,
right.
Maybe I should be making sculpture.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. That was my thought, because I was going to ask you why, but you just answered the question of why sculpture. But, you know, sculpture is a three-dimensional practice. It's got, you're not bound by any edges or surfaces. And it's like you said, the ball, why not have a ball in your hands rather than try and create an image of one?
Exactly. And what happened next was about a month or two later, there was a sculpture workshop in New Haven, Connecticut, and I took that workshop, and it was like it was waiting for me.
Right.
Like, for some reason, metal. Mm-hmm. I just started to make metal sculptures from the beginning. A colleague said to me at this, oh, wow, you're making like David Smith. I didn't know who David Smith is. Mm-hmm. David Smith is one of the first, foremost American metal abstract sculptors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Look him up, he's fantastic. Within my second class, they said, you need your own room. You're making too much smoke, your pieces are too big, and you're making too much noise.
Perfect, yes, I am. That's my art, yes, I am.
So, but this is what I mean. It just naturally right. came to me. The material was waiting for me. My grandfather and father worked as metalsmiths for years.
Wow. Yeah.
And it wasn't until years later that I had, brought a couple of pieces that I cut out of metal to where my father was living. Mm-hmm. They had converted my grandfather's shop into an apartment for him. And I laid these pieces on the ground and realized when I was a kid, I used to play with metal right here.
Right there, yeah.
So it must have been in there waiting to, you know, germinate.
Now, did you work with your grandfather and your father tinkering
not really,
with metal?
I played. I just bent metal on little machines and cut out things like that, but I didn't really make anything. My grandfather did make me a steam engine, though, one time for a high school class. And I've always been someone who's collected and found things. I've made sculptures out of found objects, so a lot of my sculptures that I've done in the more recent years have all been made out of found objects, found pieces of metal that I don't manipulate.
Right.
So if I'm going to weld a book closed, or this is a hard drive right here, I find a piece that'll wrap around it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But just to take you back a little bit, I started to do that sculpture at the class, and I was making pieces human scale. Mm-hmm. And then the janitor came to me and said, now you can't leave these things here. And I was like, boom, studio. I needed a studio. I was living in New Haven, and I happened to talk to some other people at the Art Center, and they had a studio available on the Quinnipiac River.
Oh, yeah.
Right on, near Grand Street. And so I got this big, giant studio with cranes and side cranes and roller I-beams and so forth. And my work started to get large. Right from the beginning, I started to make outdoor sculptures.
Go big or go home.
Yeah, the work I was doing when I had that studio, although I did small pieces and medium-sized pieces, but I was doing a lot of, I bought an old crane, so I had an outdoor crane.
though.
And I was making pieces that were 3,000 to 6,000 pounds.
Wow.
You know, and I made them like they were a trophy. They had a big round or square base, and I could pick them up and bring them to exhibitions and so forth. And that's what happened. As I was making more sculptures, I was invited or put myself in shows throughout New England. And did that for quite a few years. And it was just before I left New Haven, around 1977, 78, when I started to weld books clothes. I left New Haven, and I started doing performance art.
Yeah.
And I would go to Yale University, where they would have kind of an open mic situation. And one time, my first time there, I like balanced chairs like 12 feet up in the air an assistant and did some kind of cacophony words of poetry kind of stuff. And then I started to organize events. And that became part of my repertoire, which was getting artists together to create a sidewalk event. If there was a parade, we would do an event. If there was a, like there was the 300th anniversary of New Haven, we did a big event. And then before I left New Haven, around 1987, 89, I did the Dadaist invasion of Lighthouse Point.
No bass.
Dadas, you better get ready. Dadas, you're gonna be dead. Dadas,
beautiful artistic ingenuity in it. It's just, it's unbelievable.
You know, I'm so delighted that I came. I've learned a lot, and I've been totally freed up.
From, it was a town and gown, Yale and the New Haven community and surrounding community of artists would come to my studios, and we'd have meetings called the Last Supper, and we would plan this this event, the Dadaist invasion.
Yes, indeed.
It's on YouTube, and it was a fun thing. I was up in the lighthouse flying big pieces of cloth. Also around that time, I started to... one of the events I did was called Holiday Wrap Inside Out, and we were given a building down near the New Haven train station, and it was 12 stories high, and I was going to wrap it like crystal, and I got these giant sails, and every time I started wrapping the building, these winds would come and rip them off, and they'd be going on the train station. I'd be really upset about it on the train tracks.
Yeah.
So I finally realized, what, I'm not going to hold these things back, I'm going to fly them. And so I started flying sails that were eight stories long.
Yeah, wow.
And five stories wide, and flying them, and I call them kinetic wind sculptures.
Yeah, sure.
So when I did the Dadaist invasion of Lighthouse Point, I flew one of those sails off the lighthouse.
Yeah.
So that was pretty pretty interesting, and I did that for a bunch of years until it was... got to be a little bit too dangerous for me.
You're doing a program or an exhibition at Map Space at Eastworks. So, and it's Altered Books, that's the title of it. Book Art Show Altered Books. So tell me about that.
Well, let me just tell you how I got involved in doing altering books myself. You know, there's a whole group of artists that have been dealing for over 20 years, and probably 60 years when you think about it, artists would be inspired by a book, mm-hmm. be it the title, the content, the object itself, and then decide to utilize it in a piece of work. Mm-hmm. And it could be glued, taped, painted on, cut in half. They fold books into flowers. I mean, it's just amazing what people do with books. I didn't know about all of this. And in 1987, 89, there was this piece of art that became very controversial. It was called Piss Christ.
Oh, yeah.
By Andrew Serrano. And right. he was in the Stux Gallery in New York City yep. at the time. And he was using artist fluids, his own blood, his own urine. And Andrew Serrano was and is, and is now a very famous photographer, was doing large photography projects. And he had this piece that was a plastic and wood crucifix in some kind of vessel filled with his urine, which he wasn't really projecting out there, except it was piss Christ. But the piece looked fantastic.
Yeah.
I mean, even religious people would come to see it because it looked like, you know, the light coming through the clouds and just dramatic.
Right, yeah.
And then people started to realize what it was.
Oh, it was huge.
And some religious people got involved, and Jesse Helms,
that's right,
a Republican, who way back then was still merging, you know, religion with politics, was upset that Andrew Serrano had received money from the National Endowment of the Arts.
Right.
Well, over the next couple of years, he used his influence, Jesse Helms, to take money away from right. the NEA. And this I was furious about. I was somewhat naive, and I was like, how could you be taking money away from a creative purpose? This is ridiculous. And so I said, I'm going to start to explore the issue of censorship myself. So I decided to take my own books. I had 10 years of a collection of sculptor books, mm-hmm. Rodin, blah, blah, blah. And I started to weld those clothes.
Right.
I wanted to inhibit something that I loved and really get into this idea of censorship.
Censorship in books, it's alive and well has been for, I'm a retired public library director, so it would always come up that certain books were not acceptable to parents and so forth. I had one parent one time had objected to putting Mad Magazine, of all things, in the young adults section of the library because she didn't think it was appropriate material, but Mad Magazine is pretty tame. It's always something that people are objecting to. There's always some sort of book that is deemed, you know, indecent or too political or too sexual and on and on.
Well, as you probably know, now libraries have a week called Banned Book Week.
Yeah. So,
and I actually exhibited my works in two libraries in Springfield during Banned Book Week, and we had the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts come down and talk about, and it's very interesting to see what young people think about when the issue of banning a book comes up.
Right.
You know, they had a really good take on it. So I started welding these books closed, and then it became kind of a life of its own.
Sure.
I started welding books that had to do with art. Here's the Critique of Reason. This is philosophy. Here's the Constitution of the United States. So some topical issues, things right. that were coming up. And of course, the Constitution, everybody's always talking about their freedom, their rights. This is always a big issue. And so I started to weld those books closed as well.
Yeah. Well, particularly in terms of philosophy or thinking, being free to think what you want, you know, independent thought and freedom of expression, but when you get down to the street level sometimes, you're not so free. And there's always somebody out there who basically it's like, well, I don't agree with that. And my answer always was, well, you can disagree, but some people do agree. So you have the right to, everybody has the right to their own opinion, but that doesn't mean that you get the right to take that book off the shelf because you find it offensive somehow.
Well, people have been offended by the fact that I'm destroying or inhibiting them from looking at books that I've dealt with here.
Oh, yeah.
So even though I'm censoring, but I'm trying to bring out the issue of censorship, and clearly one of the most important things to me is freedom.
Right.
And freedom of expression, and that's my main goal in everything that I do.
One of the things I found to be true was being in a library every now and then we would have to weed old books off the shelves that were no longer accurate or no longer in style to read, and et cetera. And I remember I just used to get complaints from people. Why are you throwing those away? Well, because they're not scientifically accurate. It's 20 years ago. The world is very different than it was portrayed in this book. And you certainly don't want your school-age kid learning bad science that's 25 years old. But very often you get that the book, which is a good thing, that the book itself as an artifact is sacred. Anything you do to a book, it riles people up because it's a book. It's got something.
It has the power in the fact that, during the Second World War, the Nazis were burning books and getting rid of literature from different cultures and artwork as well.
Yeah.
So it brings up a lot of issues for people, as it should.
Yeah, and these days we have, it's a religious-based thing, but with Muslim populations, the Quran and the Bible, and we're always contesting about that. And there was this minister down in Georgia somewhere that he was going to burn the Quran on purpose because he wanted to offend everybody. And what his point was, but it's an ongoing struggle.
So I've been doing my welded books now for about 30 years, and I continue to do them. The show Altered Books, that's going to be at the MAP space in Eastworks the whole month of April, I'll be making one or two major pieces. I have a couple very large books, and I'm planning on doing something pretty intense with them. I haven't even totally figured out what I'm going
to
do.
Oh, good. So you'll have to go to the exhibit to find out what he's up to. But the Book Art Show, Altered Books, is April 4th through 27th at the MAP space at Eastworks. And there's a number of events that are listed. On April 6th, there's a preview. Now, what's the preview?
Now, these events that Ted is talking about are what we call Art Book Wednesdays,
right,
or Book Arts Wednesdays.
Book Arts Wednesdays.
And so the first one will be the preview, which is before the opening. Some people won't be able to make the opening, and so we're going to open it up a little bit early, and people can come and preview the show. On all of these events, there'll be some live music going on, could be folk, a lot of jazz we have coming, and then there'll be some video projections and some performances going on as well.
Now, I also said one of the Wednesdays is April 20th, and you said you have an artist talk and a roundtable discussion with artists and the public. So who is going to be involved in that?
Right now we have, besides myself, we have 20 artists that have confirmed to be in the show.
Wow.
And we're hoping to get maybe another 5 or 10 more. Mm-hmm. And they're all going to be invited to participate in the round group discussion. And then the public is invited. Mm-hmm. And people, we're encouraging all the artists to invite friends, family members, and to participate in this. Part of the idea of this show, and this show is going to be an annual show, and this is the first annual show that we're going to have this book arts thing, but we're trying to educate both. A lot of artists don't know about book arts.
No.
And there are a lot of the public know nothing about book arts.
Right.
So we're trying to educate the public as to this genre of art, book arts.
Yeah, good. So you're having this show called Altered Books. What is altered books? What is altered? What is that all about?
Well, I think I mentioned before a little bit, people do all kinds of things to alter books. They sew pages together, they take pages out and make a big painting over the pages, they paint on the book, they cut, they saw. Why don't I give you an example of it?
Okay. Okay, so now we're here altering some books, and John's going to explain to me what this is a part of.
Well, altering books, of course, first we have to decide what books we're going to alter.
Yeah.
So I just have a couple examples here of some books. So this is Huddle Fever, Living in the Immigrants. So we're going to try to decide which books are we interested in altering. And why are we altering the books? Well, we're altering the books to make some kind of a statement. And we're trying to bring out some issue that the books or the author had to say about it. So here's the C.S. Lewis. I think we'll pass on that one for now. It was a BBC series, but... So here we are, The Huddled Fever, and what was that, the subtitle, Living in the Immigrant City, and then The Natural Thing, Land and Its Citizens. So we could alter this one, and this could bring out the issue of climate change,
environmental degradation.
Environmental issues and so forth. And then, of course, Living in the Immigrant City. This is what we're all dealing with today.
All talking about.
In our own country. And, of course, around the world.
In our own neighborhoods, too.
It's one of the worst problems going on in the world right now, with immigrants just stuck in a place with hardly any food.
Yeah, the refugee crisis.
And we keep on going over this generation after generation.
We do.
I think we're done with the immigrant issue, and it keeps raising its ugly head.
Right.
So let's see how we can manipulate the book on immigrants, okay? And... it's kind of a statement against Donald Trump, if I may say. And politics, of course, comes into art and all the issues that we have to study here. So let's manipulate this in some way. So we have a drill here, and we don't know how it will respond. Every book is different, of course. And so we're going to see how this will change.
A little bit of smoke pouring up there, that's all right.
This is actually not smoke, this is the dust of the paper.
Yeah, okay.
So here's the manipulation. You can see, if you can zoom in on this, that you're seeing the interior of the book coming to the outside. So here's a manipulation.
Oh, what a...
It's kind of really an interesting visual effect.
Also, thought-wise, the inside coming out.
Yeah,
so when you read a book, that's what you're doing.
Right. And what we're trying to do is bring out the issue of immigrants.
Bring out the issue.
In a way that's a little torturous. So, if we've done our job correctly, we've manipulated this book in several ways. We've brought some of the inside outside. We've also made it so we can see through the book.
And see through the problem, yes.
Okay? Or see into the issues that are going on. Now, what if we want to get deeper into the issues of immigration? Let's see if we can try to do something else here, okay?
Let me take this.
Don't try this at home.
Yes, he's a professional. So
I've been manipulating books for 30 years.
So we're going to cut through the issue, as we are so
we're
going to
try to get a little deeper into the issue of immigration in America and around the world today.
Okay. We can't get through it yet.
So it's bound up a little bit. Oh, that was great. That was great. So see, now you can see how the book is getting manipulated. And there we have a manipulated book on the issue of immigration. And you can see how the issue is trying to spread across the whole environment.
That's right. So now what do we have?
The book can be exhibited in different ways, and you can manipulate it further.
Yeah.
And I think this is going to actually end up in the Authored Books show.
Hey, good. We got
a, you know, this is a new book with a current issue. And remember, the Authored Books show is the whole month of April.
Right.
In the Eastworks building, and it's supported by the East Hampton, what is it called?
East Hampton City Arts.
East Hampton City Arts supports us, and Eastworks as well.
Right. Now, I have a question. Now, if you exhibit this on a pedestal in your show, you would have to have some, would you have some sort of text that explains kind of what the what this is about? Because I kind of suspect some people would look at this and say, oh, yeah, there's a book that's got a hole in it, it's all cut up, but it doesn't necessarily connect with that.
I think what I would do artistically is find the page that speaks about immigrants and maybe glue it where it can be seen, and I think that would be enough.
Right, right. Because sometimes people need direction.
Yeah. I don't like to give a lot of direction in the art.
Well,
if somebody came and looked at a piece like this, you know, what would I say, you know?
Well, that is a very topical issue with the conflict between the government and Apple.
This is a hard drive. And it's been bound.
Yeah.
This is part of my 30 years bound. Ironbound book series, and you're right.
Here's a
part of a computer that's holding information. There's real information in there.
This
was used by a person, and now it's unavailable. And as you say,
it's unavailable.
We currently are, as we speak, having a national or an international discussion about who is allowed to
and why and if at all.
Right, get this information or not.
Yeah. Well, John, thanks for the demonstration here and the talking about the principles behind this and your art and your sculpture. Once again, he's having an exhibition at the Map Space. It's a book art show entitled Altered Books, and it's April 4th through the 27th at Eastworks, the Map Space at Eastworks. And there are some book arts Wednesdays that are on the schedule here. This post, we'll put this in the credits so that people can see it, and it'll be around town, and I think it's on the ECA website as well. So everybody come on down and see. It'll be there for a month, so you can wander in, wander out. But if come on Wednesdays, you have several different...
Which day do we have the book sculpture? We're going to be actually making a public book sculpture. Is that down
the
here?
13th.
On the 13th will be... The book happening, I don't know if it is.
Book happening and reading.
Yeah, I don't know whether it got... Oh, this is the table discussion on the 20th.
On the 20th.
So I think you're right. On the 13th, just remind everybody, come on down, bring a book, bring a couple books, and as a group, we're going to make a large group sculpture. We might drill through books, put ropes through them, metal bars through them. We might glue books together, so... Bring down some books and think about making a book sculpture yourself. You know, this is something that is new to a lot of people, even though it's been going on for years. We hope to see you at the Altered Book Show.
People get to participate. Yep. Hands-on, that's great.
Good.
Thank you very much, John, for coming in. We could talk a lot longer about all sorts of things. But now, from all of us to all of you, I'm Ted Perch and I'm still your host. Thank you for joining us on In Studio today, and we'll see you next time.
And aloha.
Aloha. Aloha. Okay. Thank you.